Welcome to Elizabeth's Chronicles. If you love true crime, consider subscribing. Christopher Michael Benoit was born on May 21, 1967 in Montreal, Quebec, in Canada. His parents were Michael and Margaret Benoit. Chris's childhood home was in Edmonton, Alberta. Chris loved wrestling from a young age and started training at the age of 12. Benoit won numerous bodybuilding and wrestling awards throughout high school. His father stated how he was obsessed as a small child at the thought of becoming a wrestler. Benoit never outgrew this obsession. His professional career began in 1985, in the Stampede wrestling promotion, where Benoit wrestled in a tag team match, and won. He was quickly given the nickname of Dynamite due to his physical strength and lightning speed. This kick-started his career. He moved to Japan and joined New Japan Pro Wrestling, NJPW, and wrestled under the name The Pegasus Kid. He also wore a mask for some time and wrestled in Mexico as well as Europe. He won a few championships during that time. By 1992, he wrestled at the World Championship Wrestling, WCW. There he was noticed for his outstanding wrestling skills. He continued to excel in the wrestling sport, and held 22 championships throughout his 22-year career. Benoit was in numerous pay-per-views for WWE, including when he won the World Heavyweight Championship main event match of WrestleMania 20 in 2004. He was considered to be one of the top five all-time greats, according to history journalist Dave Meltzer. Benoit was married twice, and had a daughter and a son with his first wife, Martina. By the end of 1997, the marriage had soured, and Benoit had moved on, and living with Nancy Sullivan. Chris and Nancy's son Daniel was born on February 25, 2000. The two married on November 23 of the same year. This would be Nancy's third marriage. Nancy filed for divorce in 2003, stating that the marriage was irrevocably broken, and she accused Benoit of cruel treatment. She filed for a restraining order, alleging that he would break things and throw furniture when angry or upset. The two reconciled, and the divorce and restraining order were both dropped. In November of 2005, Benoit's best friend, Eddie Guerrero, was found in his hotel room dead. That following evening, a tribute show was held by Raw and SmackDown wrestlers. Benoit broke down on camera at the loss of his friend. He was visibly devastated and emotionally distraught.
Eddie Guerrero is my best friend, and I'm sure there's a lot of people that he knew that would be able to say the same thing about him. He was such a beautiful person, such a kind-hearted person. I couldn't find the words. Words couldn't describe what kind of a human being Eddie truly was. I'd known Eddie for just about 15 years and spent a good portion of them 15 years with him on the road. We laughed together, cried together, fought each other. We've been up and down each and every mountain, each and every highway. And Eddie always led by example. You know, he was the one friend that I had that I could go to and pour my heart out to if I was going through something, if I had a personal issue or a personal problem. He was the one guy that I could call and talk to and know that he would understand and he would talk me out of it, you know, because of all the experiences that he'd been through. I believe in leading by example, and Eddie always led by example through his life, through the obstacles that he went through and conquered and became a better person, and he'd often use that as an example. we never left each other without telling each other that we loved each other. And I truly can say that I love Eddie Guerrero. He's a man that I can say I love, and I love his family, and my heart, and my thoughts and my prayers go out to his wife Vicky, Shaw, Sherilyn, and Kaylee. I can't imagine the sorrow that they're going through right now, and the emotions that they're feeling. But I want them to know that my prayers and my thoughts are with them. And Eddie, I know that you're in a better place, and I know that you're looking down on me right now. And I only know that I love you. I miss you. Eddie, you made such a great impression on my life, and I want to thank you for everything you've ever given me. I want to thank you from my heart and tell you that I love you, and I'll never forget you, and that we'll see each other again. I love you, Eddie.
On Tuesday, June 19th, Chris Benoit wrestled his last match. He defeated Elijah Burke on an episode of ECW. Tomorrow he was pitted against CM Punk for the ECW Championship at the Vengeance pay-per-view, but he would never make this match. On Friday, June 22nd, Benoit called to let them know he could not wrestle at the SmackDown House show due to his wife and son being sick from possible food poisoning. Benoit left a voicemail for Chavo Guerrero advising him that he overslept, and also missed his flight, and that he would still be at Beaumont later on that day. When Guerrero called back, he stated that Benoit sounded groggy and tired, but he confirmed his message. Guerrero was a little worried about Benoit due to how he sounded, so he tried to call him back, but got no answer. About 12 minutes later, Benoit called him back claiming he missed his call because he was on the phone with Delta Airlines, changing his flight. Benoit claimed that he had a stressful day, due to Nancy and Daniel's food poisoning. While on the phone with Guerrero, Benoit received a call from a co-worker, so he answered. He told the co-worker that Nancy and Daniel was vomiting blood. After that conversation ended, he called Guerrero back and asked him for advice, but he didn't know what to tell Benoit. On Sunday, June 24th, Benoit sent 5 text messages out between 3:51 a.m. and 3:58 a.m. 4 of the messages were just giving his address out. The last of the messages advised that the family dogs were in the enclosed pool area and that he had left the side garage door open. On Monday, June 25th, Chavo Guerrero and Scott Armstrong showed their text messages to officials at WWE, who forwarded them to the Fayette County Sheriff's Office. At 2:30 p.m. authorities made entry to Benoit's residence and found the bodies of all 3 members of the Benoit family. At 4:14 p.m. the police notified officials at WWE of the deaths and that an investigation was underway. The investigation showed that Chris Benoit had strangled Nancy on Friday. She was found bound in a towel with her arms and legs tied. A Bible was lying beside her. Injuries indicate that Benoit pressed his knee firmly into her back as he pulled on a cord around her neck. There was blood found under her head. The medical examiner stated that Daniel Benoit was sedated with Xanax and unconscious when he was murdered. He was then suffocated in his bedroom on Saturday, a full day after his mother's death. His throat had internal injuries but no outward bruising. A Bible was also lying next to him. Benoit used his weight equipment one last time. He removed the bar and made a noose from the cable so that when he released the weights, it would strangle him. he was found hanging from the pulley cable. Later it was revealed that over the weekend of the murders, Benoit's search history showed that he was researching the quickest way to break a neck. Dr. Chris Sperry, Georgia's chief medical examiner, said toxicology tests found drugs in all three bodies, notably, elevated levels of steroid, testosterone in Chris Benoit, and therapeutic amounts of Xanax and oxycodone. Nancy also had therapeutic levels of both Xanax and oxycodone. Daniel had only Xanax in his system. The media reported that steroids were found in the home, speculating that the murders could be linked to roid rage, which is uncontrollable anger and paranoia, brought on by the use of steroids. However, authorities determined there was clear planning, not rage. Benoit bound his wife's hands and feet. She was strangled, and not beaten. Nearly a full day passed before he killed his son, indicating that rage played no part. It was a deliberate act. World Wrestling Entertainment Incorporated, Benoit's employer, said after his death that Benoit had passed a random drug test in April. At the time of Benoit's death, research into CTE, chronic traumatic encephalopathy, in former football players, found that the brains of deceased NFL players showed the kind of brain damage seen in someone suffering from Alzheimer's disease or dementia. Chris Benoit's father, Michael Benoit, agreed to allow his son's brain to be tested. Chief of neurosurgery at West Virginia University, Julian Bales, confirmed that Benoit's brain showed signs of CTE and multiple trauma to the head. This was confirmed with medical history that noted multiple concussions. Bales went on to say that Benoit's brain resembled that of an 85-year-old Alzheimer's patient. It was concluded that he had severe damage to all four lobes of his brain, and also the brain stem. And that his repeated concussions led to dementia, which can cause severe behavioral problems. At the time of Benoit's death, over 65 professional wrestlers had also died at early ages prior to Benoit. Authorities began looking into Dr. Phil C. Astin III, who was the personal doctor for Chris Benoit and other wrestlers. It was determined he was illegally prescribing drugs at alarming amounts. He was ultimately arrested and charged. He pled guilty to all 175 counts and received a 10-year sentence. This case demonstrates the irreparable damage that can be done when a doctor violates his oath to help others, and instead chooses the path of illegal drug dealing, U.S. Attorney David Namias said. On July 31, 49-year-old Richard Smith failed to show up for work, after a few days of him failing to show as an IT specialist for the Department of Homeland Security, authorities were notified to do a welfare check. Richard Smith and his brother, John Smith, age 47, lived with their mother, Vonsile Smith, age 77. The Escambia County Sheriff's Office went to the home in Deerfield Drive, Pensacola, Florida. Upon entering, found the three dead. The medical examiner estimated their deaths to be on July 28. Police began their investigations, and since the older brother, Donald Harting, had been at the home for dinner on the evening of the murders, they brought him in for questioning. A neighbor noticed that he was there all day up until very late that night, and when he left, it was dark, but he left his headlights off. On July 31, police searched Harting's residence and found the murder weapon and clothes that may have been worn during the crime, and a Wiccan or pagan worship room. The media then dubbed him as the Blue Moon Killer. They brought him in for questioning. On August 3, a co-worker who works closely with Harting told police that during a conversation, Harting stated he would inherit his mother's estate because he's the oldest living heir. On August 10, police interviewed Vonsile's estate attorney. It was discovered that Harting's mother had removed him completely from her will. On October 14, the medical examiner's report declared all victims' deaths as homicide. Authorities believe that Harting was not in the will, and the only way to get the money was to eliminate all other heirs, leaving him the sole living survivor to inherit it all. On October 27, 2015, Harton was arrested and charged with 3 counts of first-degree premeditated murder with a weapon. On November 10, Harton was indicted by a grand jury on all charges. On January 21, trial began. During which, jurors were shown inside the worship room in Dartung's home. It had books about witchcraft, an Ouija board, and various relics. Testimony from a neighbor contradicted Dartung's statements of when he left his mother's home on the night of the murders. Harton stated he left before his brother, Richard, arrived home. The neighbor testified that he saw Harton leave the house after his brother, Richard Smith, returned home. During the trial, the medical examiner testified that all 3 victims were struck multiple times with a claw hammer, and their throats slit. And Richard Smith was also shot in the right ear. It appeared that the mother was tortured, her pinky finger was severed, in order to get the safe combinations. After 6 days of testimony, the jury found Harton guilty, and sentenced him to life in prison without the possibility of parole. He is incarcerated at the Graceville Correctional Facility, in Jackson County, Florida. With Chris Benoit, he had a successful career, but not without its consequences. His numerous head injuries and concussions seems to have contributed, if not caused, the death of his entire family. With Donald Harton, he was a man driven by greed. He slaughtered his 2 brothers and own mother to wipe out all living relatives, to ensure he was the only living heir. He was a cold and heartless man, who deserves to spend the remainder of his life behind bars. That concludes this episode. Stay tuned for episode 8, coming soon. If you enjoyed this video, consider subscribing.